Good morning, everyone. Everyone is here pretty well. That's wonderful. We did the introduction yesterday, and now we get into some of the analytical stuff with project management. And if I'm not loud enough, just you know, signal like this, and I'll make sure I become audible to all of you. The part where we take off today is what you see in the slide. In a couple of minutes, you'll see that we have a sequence of tasks. This is to achieve a particular mission in our simple language, which has a certain scope. This project has a certain scope, and that when it's broken down into deliverables and tasks to be done, you end up with a list of tasks, and this is called basically the work breakdown structure, WBS. That is then technologically sequenced, because you can't start the rear end before you do the front end type of thing. So we got to make sure we sequence them right, and for that we got to reach into the expertise of domain experts. They tell us what comes first, what comes next. Many times the project manager himself, he does not have domain knowledge, but he's an expert in systems, in the systems approach. He's very much familiar with the framework and so on in which things have to be cast. Therefore, it's very important for him to recognize that the domain expert has a big role here. He's the one who basically tells you in what sequence these tasks have to be done. You'll see in a couple of minutes, you'll see on the slide, we have this slide up here. There we have a certain task to be done, and that is about installation of a particular software, completed system design. And these have been identified as nodes here. You see the nodes here. Those basically identify the tasks that have to be done and the sequence in which they'll have to be done. This is the beginning of your planning. Your planning must begin with this, first of all, listing of the tasks which come from WBS, and then sequencing where help is provided by the domain expert. What we do next is, we try to approach this. This is your Gantt chart. In fact, if you walk into any project management office, you'll probably see Gantt charts on people's desks, on the walls, and so on. In fact, the largest Gantt chart I saw was in Dallas, where they were actually showing how the space shuttle is to be launched, starting with subcontract work, fabrication, assembly, transport, and then putting out the test beds there, firing the engine, testing them, and so on and so forth, then getting the astronauts ready and so on, making sure they have all their checks and everything, they are fed well, and all those things that have to be done. Then, of course, they get into the chamber, they are there for a few hours, and then the launch takes place. This whole thing was charted. This whole thing was charted, and would you believe it was a room that was about 100 feet by 100 feet, and the wall was plastered with these charts. Now, obviously, there was no one who was managing everything. These had been broken into smaller tasks. So there were sub-projects that eventually linked up and made the total project. So here we've got a few tasks on this thing there. You probably have the PDF. Locate new facilities. This is the project where we are relocating, let's say, from the old campus to this new campus. Some department is to move here and is going to be creating some new facility, including, you know, setting up the new offices, classrooms, and so on, and also probably hiring some new staff. And then, of course, this will be launched. The facility would be launched. So locate new facilities. So here is a decision that is to be made by people who decide on the location itself. Then alongside, you could also be interviewing of the staff, because we know the mission of this project. We know exactly what this facility is supposed to deliver. So there we have requirements. So interview staff, that of course goes into, you know, it'll have decomposition into reviewing the CVs, inviting CVs, getting your feedback, and so on and so forth. And then eventually coming up with the list of people you want to interview, and then interview the task. That has been shown here to start coincident with location search. Those things, because the task has to be done, so this will be also started alongside the other part that is going there. Once this part is complete, then you go ahead and do your hiring and start training the staff. That's what you'll be doing right after that, and the Gantt chart shows that. Then you've got select and order furniture, which is to follow after you've got decisions made about the location, the rooms that you select, and so on and so forth. Then you order the appropriate furniture. That will take some time, and that time is shown as the green bar there. Then, of course, you'll remodel the facility and so on and so forth. And the last part is when you move in and do the startup. That's like the thing. So this is the total project. This obviously is a snapshot view. It does not have the kind of details that can let you find out With this, you can only approximately find out how long the project is going to take. But to try to do that better, you need to do CPM. And those are a couple of techniques. One is CPM, and the other is PERT. And we'll look at that in a couple of minutes. We'll be looking at that. So the Gantt chart, basically, this was the Gantt chart. The Gantt chart basically is a graphic display of the total tasks involved. And basically, in the Gantt chart, you show the main task, the primary task. That's what you show there. Later on, a subcontractor may pick up the first part, and he may blow it up into a large project. And that's his project, so he will have all the details and so on and so forth. That will be there. But for you, it is just one sub-project or even one task to complete this total task that is there. So the Gantt chart will graphically depict estimated times, because that's how you get the length of the bar. And later on, you might bring in some resource requirements also. That will come later. But that is also something that you have to keep in mind. Once I'm going to be identifying a particular task, I'll require resources. I'll probably have to budget them, and I'll have to do all kinds of things later on with this. But at this time, I just have a representation of the task as a green bar. The task must be put in the logical order, the order in which they come, and that will come from the domain expert. The domain expert is going to tell you what comes first, what comes next, and so on. And this is a real easy way to display the overall schedule. It's a real easy way. For example, you are a vice president and you are in a pharmaceutical company. You've got four projects going, four molecules they are being researched on. So basically, if you walk into the R&D area, right up front, on the front wall, they'll have probably four Gantt charts showing the status of these four different projects. That will be shown right there. So that's like, it's a great way to communicate. It's a great way to communicate with the sponsors and those who are involved in the project. And also let people know what all projects are running in your company. That's like, it's an easy way to show that. Of course, one should not stop with the Gantt chart. You need much more, you know, a lot more details than just doing this. But the sad part of the story is not many people prepare even the Gantt chart. That's the very unfortunate part. And those are the reasons why many times projects fail. They fail because good planning has not been done. I'm preparing the Gantt chart, not at the C conceptualization stage, but defining and designing the project, the planning phase. That's when I'm preparing the Gantt chart. So you'll see more details. As you get deeper into it, you'll see more details. Many times, you utilize IT to try to capture the details, to display the details, and to have the relevant reports shown and so on and so forth. If you look at a project management tool such as Primavera, or you look at MS Project, they do this task for you. They do this job for you. We'll get some practice in using MS Project. By the way, MS Project has been installed in our lab PCs. So there are about 40, 45 PCs there. They all have MS Project installed already there. So what you could do is take a small project and just try it out. Try it out. And those of you who have already worked in MS Project, they probably can hold the hands of others. Otherwise, come and see me, and I'll make sure I go out to the lab there and I show you how to actually get your own project information put up on a task and get a display like that. So that would be done later. Let's now get into the analytical part of project planning. The part we'll be focusing on right now is to come up with a proper schedule. So we're looking at only the time dimension here. There are three objectives that we got to worry about. We got to have requirements, we got to have time, otherwise we got the budget to take care of. Requirements are, of course, first and foremost. You've got to have requirements, otherwise you cannot really deliver the charter, you cannot deliver the scope of the project. So that is there. Once that is given to you, then you get into the, you go and walk up to the domain expert, you ask him what details are involved in carrying out this project. And they start then talking, they start giving you details, they give you the timings, they give you the cost, and they also tell you what kind of expertise would be required, so you can identify kind of resources required for carrying out certain tasks. You know, the same guys, they can't do everything. So you got to make sure you match the requirements with people who are available. Sometimes if you are limited in resources, that may stretch out the project. And tools like MS Project, for example, they can actually show you the impact of having limited resources and the impact of that on the overall project. And then we'll also take a look at something called crashing, which is like putting additional resources on certain tasks so that you can compress the time. Let's say the deadline is only 6 months away and the project is going to take 8 months by your plan. Then you take a look at tasks that might require additional resource so that you can compress them. This task is called crashing, and it's got to be done in a manner which optimizes things. And I'll try to do some of this on paper here. I'm somewhat limited, a handicap, because the light pen is not working, but I'll try to see if I could convey the things with on by writing this sheet of paper here. So PERT or CPM, they are used together, but they are not synonymous. PERT has a particular goal, CPM has a particular goal. They both follow the chart. They both follow the activity chart, and we'll take a look at how it is done. What both PERT and CPM charts do, they graphically model the sequence of project tasks. That's something the PERT and CPM networks do. Now you end up with a network of activities. That's what you end up with. It will also help you, particularly the CPM will help you find the critical path. The critical path is the sequence of tasks. If any task is delayed on this path, the whole project is going to be delayed. So this is the path that you got to watch. If there are any kind of slippage of time, for example, on any of these tasks, you should flag it. It's a sign that the project is going to be delayed. And later on, I'll show you there are techniques called EVM, for example, Earned Value Management, where you basically try to find out what is the delay due to, what is it due to, because of lack of resource or something else or some environmental factor or whatever it is. If an activity on the critical path is affected, you better make sure you have the resources and so on to be able to carry through the task. The CPM and the PERT network, they both let the managers estimate the total task, total amount of work required to complete the thing, total amount of time required, and also any task slippage. That also is tracked by doing this. And it can actually, if you use CPM or PERT, you can reduce your cost. You can also finish your project on time, because it keeps things visible. In fact, if you look at a chart like this display, this is just showing the plain basic Gantt chart. But alongside, you can also plot the progress of the project. And you can track the variance from actual. If there's the actual, then there's the plan. That variance also you can track by visually looking at this thing, which task is getting fouled up, which task is getting okay, and which tasks are getting finished ahead of time. We'll take a look at all that once we get into this thing. So there are these two basic methods. One is called the critical path method. The other is called PERT. They're quite different. They both use networks of activities, but their goals are different. CPM is totally deterministic. Deterministic means I assume that the times have no randomness. The time estimates that are given to me, they are fixed. They are known and they are fixed. And therefore, the activity time, the total activity time also turns out to be a deterministic quantity with CPM. PERT gets a little bit into time risk management or slippage of deadline, for example. So it treats the activity times as random variables. And we use a simple model to capture that randomness. I'll show you that in a couple of minutes. How we capture the randomness that might be there in real life, how we capture that into a PERT network. Still, the network is the same, but the timings used for PERT analysis, these acknowledge the randomness. And they exploit the randomness to try to make some predictions about what is the chance of missing the deadline. That's something that is done very easily using the PERT network. We'll see that in a couple of minutes. Now, here's the beginning of a little task we'll be doing. I have the same project that you saw earlier, which is like moving from old campus to new campus. And when I spoke with I made a list of all the tasks. Then I spoke with the expert who is an expert in moving equipment and moving people and relocating and so on and so forth. And he said, sir, if you want to do this right, this is the sequence in which you'll be doing it. So if you look at this thing, what I'd like to suggest to you is draw this on a sheet of paper. Draw this on your network, because we'll be working with this. Draw this, take a couple of minutes. You have these nodes. Nodes here are milestones. So the very first one, node number one, is starting the project. Node number two is when you've accomplished location of facilities. That's a milestone. Node number four is when you've ordered furniture. Ordering is complete. That's a milestone. Node number three is when your interviewing is complete. That's a milestone again. Node number five is when you've got the furniture all set up, when you've got remodeling of the facilities done, maybe erecting some new walls, installing cameras and stuff like that, you've done all that. And also you've got the human side taken care of, you've got the hiring done, you've got the training done. When all these three things are done, only then you can move in. So you see the node here, which is 5, that's a milestone. When I've got this task, furniture setup done, remodeling done, and hiring and training done. I've accomplished 3 milestones. I've reached this node that is designated 5. Then of course I can do the last part of the project, which is moving in. And when I reach the node 6, when I reach node number 6, I've accomplished the total project, and in fact that's the milestone, the project is complete. Now this is just basically the description of it. Now that's not good enough for management. Okay, I understand how the project will be done, but how long it is going to take. This is where we will need to bring in the time dimension of it. So my basic network is set up here. I have to imprint, I have to bring in now additional information, which will be time information. In fact, the thing that I would like to discover is the longest time taken to complete all the tasks, because that's going to be the duration of the project. Now, some of you have been working in project management, it's kind of obvious that you need to find this out, so that then you can actually commit a particular deadline. You can actually tell them, I'll be done by, let's say, March 15th, I'll be done with the project. To reach that point, you have to identify the critical path, which means you'll have to draw a network, like the kind of network we have there, but you have to augment this with times, with activity times. You'll also have to identify, for example, are there any slacks in some particular task? Are there some slacks there? Slacks are very handy in terms of reallocating resources. If a particular task has a lot of slack, probably you can spare those people and they can go out and help on a task that's on the critical path. This way, you end up keeping everything up to speed pretty well, and you make the good use of, make the best use of resources at your disposal. The total project time, of course, is the goal. That's what we want to reach. Of course, in the CPM scenario, and also in the PERT scenario, you do not assume any kind of constraints of resources, due to resources. You assume lots and lots of resources are available. The only dimension you're looking at here is the time to finish, given lots and lots of resources. No limits on budget, no limits on basically resource availability. You just want to see, most optimistically, when can I finish this project? That's the goal. Let's see how we do that. I have to bring in a particular topology. Now, there are 2 topologies used. The one that I showed you earlier, notice here, the activities are on arrows. The activities here, basically, if you see them, when I switch to the paper here, you can actually see, this is the activity locate facilities, it's on an arrow. Order furniture is also on an arrow. This sort of diagram is called activity on arrow diagram, activity on arrow diagram. This is like one way to represent the CPM network. There's another approach which is called activity on node, and that is this one. The same information, what I've done here is, I've made the nodes the activities themselves. So here, some people prefer this mode, some people prefer this topology, but I personally prefer the activity on arrow type. So that's the one we'll be using for our analysis. But you should really know how to switch back and forth, because there are certain things that are possible with the activity of node topology, which is not possible with the activity on arrows topology. Given that, what we do is, we try then to talk to people who have done similar work before, and we try to come up with time estimates. So if I look at time estimates, I bring the next sheet, which will be right here, and that's your next slide. And now if you look at this sheet, you'll notice there are times. So there's 8 weeks there for this task, 6 weeks for this task, 3 weeks for this task, 11 weeks for this task, 4 weeks here, 9 weeks here, 1 week there. Now, given this, and someone who's just done high school, that means he can add and so on and so forth, he can compare and add. If you ask him, please tell me the total finish time for this project, what he will do is he'll trace all the paths. From beginning to the end, he'll trace all the paths. So I've got 8 plus 6 plus 3 plus 1, that'll be some number. 8 plus 11 plus 1, that'd be another number. 4 plus 9 plus 1, that'd be a third number. The longest path, whichever one it turns out to be, is going to be the duration of the project. The other tasks, they are going to have the slack. So can you quickly tell me what the longest path is? 1, 2, 5, 6. That's the longest path. which actually means even if I'm doing two activities here on this front, it looks like 6 plus 3 is going to be smaller than 11. And this is the guy who is going to be, that is going to be delaying this one and this one. Now I've got to make sure I now trace the, I can trace the critical path here. But just doing it this way does not tell me one small thing. It does not tell me the amount of slack in here and the amount of slack in here. And also it does not tell me the slacks available at these activities. It does not do that. So for that we've got to do a little bit of calculation. And let's see how easily that can be done. What we do is we'll start with the blank sheet and we go back to this, our writing sheet here. I say if this is the activity and this is my starting node, what is the earliest time I could start this activity? Time is 0, right? So earliest start here is going to be 0. Earliest finish is going to be earliest start plus 8. So earliest finish for this task is going to be 8. What is the earliest start time for this guy? Earliest start, it's going to be 8. So earliest start here is 8. Then I look at this one, earliest finish for this, I only have to complete this task. 8 plus 6, 14, earliest finish is 14. I come to this side and I say, my God, that task. It could start only when this task is done. Therefore, the earliest start here for this task is going to be 8. Earliest finish here is going to be 19, that is 8 plus 11, 19. I look at this task, the earliest it could begin is 14. Earliest start is 14 because that's when this guy gets finished. And I start from that milestone and I add 3 to 14, I end up with 17. Earliest finish here is 17. I come to this side, what is the earliest start for this guy? 0. Earliest start is 0. Earliest finish for this guy is going to be 4 plus 0, that is 4. Earliest start on this side is going to be 4. Earliest finish from this branch is going to be, earliest finish is going to be 9 plus 4, that is 13. Now look at this task. This task cannot be started till this is done, this is done, this is done. And the earliest finish turns out to be this guy. So the earliest start for this task is going to be 19. Earliest start is going to be 19 there. Earliest finish for the project is going to be now 19 plus 1. Earliest finish is 20. 20 is the length of the critical path. 20 turns out to be the length of the critical path. This is one way to do it. One way to get the what we call the forward pass through the network. Of course, what we have to do is we've got to identify the slacks. We haven't done that yet. I mean, it could be probably done somehow. But let's see how we do it precisely, how we do it using some analytical work. This number is fixed. The n number is fixed. Therefore, quite easily, I could actually start here. The latest finish for this task is going to be 20. If I finish it any later, the project will be delayed. So the latest finish required now, if I commit to 20 weeks as the duration of the total project, it's going to be, latest finish is going to be 20. The latest start for this task, latest start, it will be finish plus this task minus this task. So it's going to be latest start for this guy is going to be 20 minus 1, that is 19. Try to check now the latest finish for this one, this task. This needs to begin, the earliest start is 19. Even if I finish at 17, I've got some extra time there. So the latest finish is going to be when this guy starts, that's all. I need not really, you know, there's no reason for me to start it any early. So latest finish is going to be 19 for this task. Yeah. Yes, surely. See, I'm trying to find for this particular task, I know I'm going to be finishing at 20 weeks. At the end of 20 weeks, I'll be done. And this task takes, so what is the latest finish for this task? However much time it might be taking, it must be finished by 20 weeks. The latest start of this is going to be that 20 minus the duration of this task. So it's 20 minus 1, that's latest start for this task is 19. Okay, now look at this guy. this one must be completed, this one must be completed, also this one must be completed in order for this to begin. But the latest start of this is 19. If any of these get delayed even beyond that, then of course this task will get delayed. That means the whole path is going to be delayed, whole project is going to be delayed. So the latest finish for this guy, it's like saying the latest arrival time of a student here is 8:30. If anybody comes after that, the class is going to be delayed. So imagine this to be the start of the class, start of the project management class. These are different people arriving. I say the latest for you to arrive, latest arrival time is going to be basically when the class starts, just before that, an instant before that. So the latest finish is going to be 19. What about this one? What do you think will be the latest finish for this? 19 again. Latest finish is 19. Latest finish for this task also going to be 19. Latest finish is going to be 19. Please don't feel rushed. I'm going to give you a very simple example after this, and I'll let you work on this. But right now, just copy this down so you can at least see what the mechanical process is. The latest start of this guy, latest start of this guy, the task is going to take 19, and the latest I can finish is, latest finish is 19, and the task is going to take you 9 weeks. So what is the latest start? 19 minus 9, it's going to be 10. Let's think through this again. I must finish by 19. At the end of the 19 weeks, I must finish. And I have to make sure I give it enough time for this task to be completed. So how late can I start this task? 19 minus the duration of this task. That's 10. Is this clear? Or should I slow down more? Look at this one. Look at this task. Look at this task. It must finish by 19. Because this guy has to start by 19. That's the latest start for this, otherwise the project would be delayed. It takes 1 week to go from here to here. So I got to make sure I really have enough time for it to have the latest start as late as possible. The latest finish for this is going to be then something that should not delay this task. So that's 19. This task would take 11 weeks. What should be the latest start of this? Latest start. 19 minus 11. Is this clear? Not clear. Somebody should say not clear. I feel happy. Okay, you are okay then. So 19 minus 11, that's going to be 8 there. I look at this side now. This task takes 3 weeks. Latest finish is 19. What would be the latest start of this? How late do you think I could? 16, because the task takes 3 weeks. I must finish in by 19 weeks. So it will be 19 minus 3, 19. Minus 3, which is equal to latest started 16. Latest finish for this guy, if it is anything beyond this, I'll again have trouble. So latest finish here is going to be 16. And this guy takes 6 weeks. So the latest start here, latest start is going to be 16 minus 6, right? That's going to be 10. I've got the latest start there, latest finish there, and so on. But look at this guy now. This is the tricky one. Latest start is 8. I can't delay it anymore. When do you think this task should finish? 8. So latest finish for this is going to be 8. Let's debate this a little bit. Suppose I finished in 10 weeks. I took 10 weeks to get to this point. What would happen down the road? Everything will be delayed. So I've got the backward calculation done to try to make sure when is the class going to start, and I start backward planning from that. So the class is going to start at this point, and I find that if it goes beyond any of them, I can't finish at latest start. That would just mean that this task will be ready, but this will be delayed. So I finish this task by 8. What will be the latest start time for this? 8 and 8, 8 minus 8 is going to be 0. I can't delay it anymore. Let's look at this side. Latest finish here is going to be how much? Latest finish? Only 10. And this guy takes 4 weeks. What will be the latest start of this? 6. So therefore, the project can start when? It can start at time 0. Now notice something. This task has latest start at 0. Also, the earliest start is 0. There is no slack. Look at this task. Latest start is 8 and earliest start is 8. Again, I've got no slack. Because it's sort of like this. How late can you arrive? You've got to be there at 8:30. And it turns out the start of the task, the earliest start is going to be 8. If they coincide, then that means you've got no slack there. I have no slack here. In fact, I can now say, I can take my pen and I can draw the critical path. This path has no slack. This path has no slack. This path also has no slack. If you count up now, 8 plus 11 plus 19 plus 1, that is 20. This is the path that's going to determine the duration of the project. Okay, so what about the other tasks? Let's take a look at what is happening there. The latest start on this task is 10 and the earliest start is 4. So I could start at the end of week 4, but I could wait as late as 10, which means I've got some slack. I've got some slack there. What is the amount of slack here? The difference between those two. So slack, I'm just going to put it in a box. Slack here is 6. The slack here is going to be 0. Slack here is going to be 0. A slack obviously on this is going to be 0. On the critical path, you'll have 0 slack. There's no room at all to play around with time. What about this guy? How much slack is there? Latest start is 6 and I could start immediately. I could wait till 6 without delaying any problem. So therefore, there is some slack. Do you understand the concept of slack? Slack means I've got some room to play. This is like the old ambassador steering wheel. You all have play, right? So before you start turning, you better watch out. You get it to the point when it almost begins to sort of move, and then you turn forward. If you just hold it in the middle, it will never turn. It will probably go all over the place. So here, I have some room there. Again, the slack here is going to be 6. Please tell me the slack on this. There is no slack there. What about the slack here? 2 is the slack there. And on this side, 2 again. 2 is the slack there. Now there's something very interesting. This guy, something very interesting going on here. It's got a black cap and blue color, but that's okay. We are all human, right? This diagram here, it basically tells you how the project is going to progress. Now you find that there are certain tasks, this one, this one, this one, and this one. They have some slack which is non-zero, non-zero slack. You do have some slack. They may have spare resources. And you could swing that resource probably to this task. You could swing that resource to this task. You could swing that resource to this task. And thereby you could speed up some of these tasks and make sure it probably would get done maybe in 18 weeks or 19 weeks, something like that, without spending any extra money. All you've done is good project management. You've reallocated people. So you've got some interview, would probably have some capable people there. Perhaps they can give you an opinion on site location. Perhaps they could give you some assistance here in remodeling if there is any physical work to be done. That sort of thing should be exploited. Whenever you've got a diagram like this, you should try to locate those opportunities where you've got some slack that is more than 0. See if you could spare some resources from there. This is not going to hurt the project in any way. It's actually going to help you speed up the project. So this is point number 1. Then we go a little beyond this. I, of course, have my calculation and exactly what we did. The same thing is defined here. Again, to give you the definition, I've got earliest start time. Yes, I've got earliest finish time, EF. I've got latest start time, LS. I've got latest finish time. These have to do with activities. And these are required to find the expected project duration. That's like something we got to do. Slack time and also critical path. So the product, the results for my doing this, this little diagram here and so on and so forth, the project, the benefits from doing this is these things. We ended up with these things. And of course, whatever we did, it's clarified here. The formulas are given. Then nothing like E equal to mc squared. This is just ABC. You add them up and you get the numbers. Now I'll give you this example. Just copy this on the thing and see if you could give me the slack time and also if you could give me the project finish time. Work this out. What kind of diagram is this? Activity on node or activity on arc? Activity on arrow. Very good. How many milestones are there? As you can see here, four milestones. Milestones, of course, they are events, so they have no time. But the activities end up having time. And I've got the times here, whatever unit it is, 3, 2, 5, 4, and 2. Those are the ones that move us between the milestones. That's what I'm given here. You try to see now if you could, obviously you could easily calculate the longest path, but that's not the total answer. Let's also try to see if we could find the earliest start and so on and so forth. Take a couple of minutes. Just to get it rolling here, the task from 1 to 2, it can start anytime. And the earliest start is going to be? Earliest start time for activity 1 to 0. Very good. Similarly, the earliest start time for activity 1 to 3 is going to be 0. You got a start there. Then you work out the earliest finish and so on and so forth. How many paths are possible to reach from 1 to 4? How many paths? Three different paths. Very good. And roughly the length of these paths? 8, 7, and 6. Very good. So I know the duration of the project now. Somebody has the answer? Couple of you have the answer? Good, very good. First of all, have you identified the critical path? Can you just call the sequence of milestones? 1, 2, 4. That's the critical path. And that's the path where the activities have no slack time. Is this clear? Okay. Then that means the other guys must have some slack. And we have to just work out their slacks. What is the slack on activity 2? One is there, good. Activity 1 connecting to 3? 2, that's a good slack there. And connecting 3 to 4? 1. So we know now, and obviously 1 to 2 there is no slack, 2 to 4 there is no slack. So we have identified pretty quickly by doing the same thing that we did earlier. And if you walk through this thing, you can verify your answer. If you want to see what the answer is here. And let's see you've done that. Then you go back and you try to see what the total task is going to be. You'll identify the critical path. So let's try to make sure we show the critical path. It's from 1 to 2 to 4. That's the critical path. The other guys have slack. What is the utility of understanding where the slacks are? What is the usefulness? I can swing resources. Very, very good. I can swing resources. And I also know now which all activities must be resourced completely in order for not to delay the project. All right, that was one picture. That was our CPM calculation. Let's now see what other things I require. Obviously, the total planning is not complete yet. I have a statement of work, which is basically what is given to contractors. They are given the parts that they are supposed to be responsible for, and they are supposed to come up with these time estimates. Of course, many times people work this out ahead of time. They try to get an idea if there is like an overpass to be built or some building has to be constructed or some engineering product has to be basically designed. They have an idea or some software has to be created. People from historical sort of sources, they can work out roughly what the task is going to be, the total task is going to take. But they also do the CPM part. And the CPM part obviously is more exact. You identify the slacks and all those things. But what have we assumed when we did the CPM work? What did we assume? We assumed two things. First was, hint is, a letter starting with, a word starting with D. Deterministic, very good. Number one. The other has to start with R. Resource. There's no resource constraint in CPM. That's like something we assume. Only then we can go ahead and do our CPM. Because if you bring in constraints of resource, that becomes a pretty complicated problem. We'll take a look at that later on. We'll try to see how we utilize the information on resource availability, that we do that. Let's now take a look at this technique called PERT. How much time, tell me, how much time does it take you to come from, let's say, a hostel to this site here? 15 minutes. Now, is that your average time? Or is that your optimistic time? Is that your pessimistic time? You gave me a good number, and that's a very good input on CPM. So if I did CPM analysis, your 15 minutes would be very handy. That would be a very good sort of input in doing that. But now let me ask you things that actually can foul up between your walk from your hostel to this place. What is your optimistic time? How quickly do you think you could get here? Optimistic means? The best time, the least time. How much is that, do you think? 7 minutes. So T optimistic is going to be 7 minutes. What about pessimistic? What kind of things can foul up in your walk? Traffic, bicycles, weather, little accident here, there, and so on. The road being blocked because there's a truck that is trying to back up the same way, or the gate is closed, or whatever it is. The security people didn't show up. These things can actually, probably they can force you to retrace your path. If things do get fouled up, how long do you think it might take you? T pessimistic. 30 minutes? Maybe 30 minutes. I won't really worry too much about it. And there is something called most likely. And the most likely may be slightly different from the average. But there is a time called T most likely. What is the most likely time? I was given a time of 15 minutes. Is that most likely? No problem. No problem. I could take 15 minutes. Or if you want to change it, I could also change it. 12 minutes. Let's put it just for kicks. Let's put it as 12 minutes. Now notice here, just by asking a few questions, I established a couple of things. One, my CPM assumption was not foolproof, was not 100%. There is this variation of real life. If you look at a real project, like the one I've got on my screen here, this is a project that has got three phases, three parts that have to be completed. And just take a look at this part here. I've got tasks here, which are like, this is activity on R. I've got activity A, then I've got activity B, then I've got activity C on the top part. Then the middle path has, middle chain has D, E, and F. And then I've got G, H, and I. Let's just recall for a minute, how did I construct the diagram? How did I construct this little picture here? What was my starting point? Starting point. Started with the charter. Then tell me, identified the scope, good. From scope, I got to WBS, work breakdown structure. And the work breakdown structure eventually brought me down to work packages. The work packages are now my tasks. Those are the tasks I'll be assigned to different contractors, subcontractors. Those are the tasks that I see here, A, B, and C. These are basically the different tasks that have to be completed by people. And then, of course, I talk to the domain expert. I talked to the domain expert, and the domain expert told me that suppose you're going to be doing this, if you're going to be doing this, you first have to do A, then you have to do B, then you have to do C. Then if you look at D, E, and F, that way you'll be getting the second task, second part of the project done. Then you do the last one, which is G, H, and I. That's the lowest part. Thank you. Good job. Sometimes managers have to act, right? So we did that. So I have here, if you look at this total project, how many tasks are involved in this? Nine tasks. Nine tasks are involved in this. I've got the sequence done there. What do you notice about the timings? What have they done? They have given you the optimistic estimate. They've given you the most likely estimate. And they've given you the pessimistic estimate. This is the information about uncertainty. This is the information about uncertainty. What I can do now, I have to kind of give a time risk projection for this project. That means I have to, from this uncertainty, I have to figure out how long this project might take. Let's see how we do that. The first thing I have to do is I have to convert these times, which have been given as 3-point estimates, a triangular estimate, I have to convert them to random variables. And it turns out if you look at any one of those tasks, it'll have a distribution. The time will have a distribution. So I have that for activity A, then I have that same thing for activity B, and I've got the same thing for activity C. That path A, B, C would end up finding a distribution of its own. The sum will have its own distribution that's actually composed from the individual random components. Now, it turns out you can't just add them because there's a random number there, there's a random number here, there's a random number here. You can't just take random numbers and add them up. You can't do that easily. What you have to do is you have to go through a process called Monte Carlo. So you'll be doing a bit of simulation. What I do in that is I express the randomness in the first task, task A. And I capture that by specifying two things. I assume that the distribution is approximately normal. And I specify its expected time, which is the mean. And the formula is given here, TO plus 4 times TM, the most likely time, plus TP divided by 6. That's the expected time to finish that task K. This is given to you for triangular distribution. If there's a little bit of theory in this, and I'll explain that to you later on. I can actually come back and I can explain that to you. This is one way to take your three estimates, TO, TP, and TM, and from that figure out the expected time. And for standard deviation, what they say is the total spread is supposed to be something like 6 sigma. So they take the difference between the back end, which is TP, minus TO, divide by 6. That's 1 sigma, and you square it to get variance. It's an approximation. See, many times you can't really exactly replicate real life in your models. So you do an approximation which is good enough, and then you check it out against reality. If it's a good enough fit, you say, fine, I'll work with this. Now, with this, what I've done is, I've got now uncertainty captured on task A, then task B, then task C. I've done that. Now, I have to compose them, and the part that I'm looking at is, obviously, if you add the three means, you'll end up with the total estimated mean of that path, A plus B plus C. For variance, what you have to do is, you have to take the individual variances, and basically then you have to square, you have to add the variances, and take the square root of the sum. That will give you sigma for the total path. So the sigma for the total path is going to be, in fact, the variance of the total path is going to be the sum of the variances of the individual activity. If I take the square root of this, I end up with my sigma. The beauty of this is, once I know the expected quantity and the quantity which is basically my variance, and then from that I get my sigma, I can construct a little variable called the Z variable. Z is a standard normal variate, which basically takes, you take any time t minus t expected divide by sigma. And this is, of course, for the path. This is also for the path. This little formula converts the total finish times for the project into a z variable. And what is the distribution for the z variable? It's the standard normal variance. What is its mean? Mean is 0. Excellent. Mean is 0. And sigma? 1. And I know most of the books of statistics or even project management books, they provide you with tables. If you go to the back of the table, you'll be able to find a table that gives you the distribution of normal variables. Once you have that in front of you, it will tell you a particular value of z. If you look at a particular value of z, what is the chance for my finding a true value of z, a real value of z beyond that value? This gives me the deadline. This way I can locate the deadline there. And this is the deadline is the total project finish time. Let me just flip the slide here and you'll see how that thing works out. This is basically what you'll end up with, and this is now the distribution of the transformed total completion time converted on the z scale by doing the little formula that we used to convert your standard normal, to convert the normal distribution into a standard normal distribution. Now, of course, I can say the white area here in this diagram, that white area is the chance of my true project going beyond the deadline. And let me show you how that is done. How many paths did we have in our diagram? Three paths. I had A, B, C. When I did my Monte Carlo, when I did my calculation, I ended up with a distribution of A, B, C. You said the P, A, B, C, that's to the left. You see the deadline. What do you think is the chance of path ABC getting delayed beyond 17 weeks? Almost zero. What is the chance of GHI path getting beyond 17 weeks? This one. Look at the bottom one. GHI. Almost no chance, but more chances than ABC. ABC is very safe. But look at DEF. This guy is the troublesome one. This guy clearly tells me that there is a substantial amount, about 15% chance of my exceeding the year deadline. Here again, I can come back and say, this is the guy that's going to be affecting my project, very likely. So what I do is I swing resources. I try to see if I could bring them back here. So this is, in fact, what is done. What I've done is, I've converted this into an Excel worksheet, and I'm going to be mailing you that worksheet. You'll actually be seeing this Monte Carlo. I will, see if I could go there for a second. The Monte Carlo will eventually end up giving a distribution like this. And here again, I began with my ABC. And this, I'm going to give you sheets like this. ABC are basically the three paths, then I've got the total finish time for this. And these are, of course, random variables. If you click on that, you'll be able to see numbers there. And they have been found by utilizing a particular formula. And that formula is built into Excel. And that's over here. The formula is given. And I'll show you again. At some other time, I'll show you how exactly to do it. You see the formula there? You probably can't see it. But never mind. I'll give you this worksheet. With that, you'd be able to very easily work out any kind of project that you have there, how to go about doing this. Okay, let's resume here just a little bit. There are some limits, of course. Our problem is, you know, many times details are ignored. Sometimes important activities may be ignored from this thing. People shy away from saying everything. And they might be including fudge factors also. So those are the real problems whenever you're looking at projects like this. Then I want to get to one topic, which has to do with crashing. Crashing is the opportunity that you utilize. Suppose your projects are getting delayed, and you want to really know, is there an activity that I could resource more? I could bring in more resources, and I could compress it a little bit. So for that, what you do is, obviously, it's going to cost you some money to compress it. What do you gain when you finish the project early? What do you think you gain when you finish a project early? What is the reason for your doing the project? Yeah, keep going. Yeah, good. So what is the business effect of finishing a project early? Yes, cash flow in future. Your revenues start earlier. So that's the trade-off. I can spend money on the project, I can compress things, and I can start my revenues coming in early. So in fact, you'll see this is what is done whenever you're trying to optimize crash. Let's take a look at this little diagram there. How many minutes I have? 5 minutes, 3 minutes, 2 minutes, couple of minutes. Good. Let's just work on this. Here's a very simple diagram, very simple project, very simple project. I have task A, and the black number here is the real time. You probably can't see it from there, but the black number is the real time, the estimated base time. And the same thing what we're applying for task B, task F, task E, and so on and so forth. Now, there's another number given here, which is in red color. They say, if you spend 1,000 rupees, you could reduce the black number to the red number. So if I, on task A, for example, if I spend 1,000 rupees, I have no effect. I cannot reduce that task. It's like growing a tree or letting the flower bloom. It's going to take its time. It doesn't matter how much water I provide. But task B is something that can cut back, that can actually reduce from being 10 weeks to 8 weeks. Same thing is true for C, same thing is true for D. D has a straight jump. It can come from 4 to 1. Now, what you actually do is you work out the deltas, the returns from all of these. Now, if I give you 1,000 rupees, what is the first thing you would do to try to reduce the duration of this project? What is the first thing you would do? You will actually work out the critical path. But those are the critical activities are the ones that really deserve the time. So if I do that, I'll end up with the identified task. And the next thing is going to be, I work out the trade-off. If I spend some money, what is the reduction? I'm going to be giving you a little exercise on this later on. And this procedure is called crashing. No matter what project you're looking at, you have to worry about resources, staffing, and these things. If you don't do them right, a lot of things go wrong. Those we'll be taking a look at. This is to be done during execution. This is also to be done in controls. Rather important things. If you do it right, the project gets done well ahead of time and so on and so forth. The customer is also happy. And you got to make sure you come to a finish point when the stakeholders have been taken care of. You've not exceeded the deadline. And also you have underspent probably if possible. That actually does not happen with too many projects because of all the things that can foul up. And for that, we'll be studying risk management later on. Thank you very much. Any questions? Yep.
For this first, we have assumed that at path, when I combine all the activities in a path, it becomes normal. But for calculating slack, I need to have information about each particular activity to find
yes.
my slack in that.
Yes.
So for me, the distribution is not normal when I go to the activity level.
Very good.
So to get the if I have to attach a probability value to it, then I need to model a distribution for that not normal activity. So how do we actually go?
Okay, two things I should clarify. One, the concept of slack belongs to CPM. And the concept of randomness belongs to PERT. PERT looks at the risk of overrun. PERT really does not really worry too much about criticality. CPM worries about criticality. So PERT is more complex. And PERT with resource limitation is very complicated. And that's where you got to have some good analysis done and so on and so forth to really locate the right task. That's what we did when we looked at that task, the task that had the distribution there. We wanted to make sure we understood the differences and we only focused on the path that really had the chance of overrun. We did not really get into CPM type of thing. We did not really calculate slack. But we identified the candidate for resourcing by doing this. This is the issue. Is that okay for you? Anybody, any other question? Thanks a lot. We'll talk to you tomorrow. Talk to you next week.